Thank you all for turning up for the lecture. It is my proud privilege to introduce my teacher, Professor Mahamudaman. Professor Mahamudaman is one of the eminent professors of English in India and has accumulated rich professional experience and expertise in the field with 40 long years of teaching. He did his PhD from Leeds University, Pakistan. He has also visited Oxford University for a year on a British Council scholarship. He primarily worked at the University of Hyderabad, which is Karma Bhumi, but taught at many universities in India and abroad. For instance, he taught in the US on a Fulbright program. Okay, Professor Ramanan has written more than 30 books and published about 75 research articles and made significant and innovative contributions to the field of literary studies. He had many administrative positions. They include the head of the Department of English, Dean, School of Humanities, Executive Council, and the visitors nominee of our own EFL University. Now about the subject. When we approach a literary text, we need to look at its literary nuances, at the same time, linguistic devices. Roman Jakobson said, "The literary scholar's ignorance to linguistic devices used in a text and the linguist negligence of literary devices can result in disastrous consequences. Very few teachers make attempt to integrate linguistic and literary elements in teaching. Of course, we had stalwarts like Professor V.K. Gokak, the first director of this institution, Alan Malley, Professor Christopher Brumfitt, and Professor V. Saraswati, to name a few. Today we have Professor Ramanan with us. We really feel honored and privileged to have you with us, sir, to talk on this interesting and relevant topic. I thank you for accepting our invitation to give a lecture on the given topic. Before I request you to give the lecture, I would like to quickly introduce my colleagues and students. Professor Upendran, the dean of our school, Professor Paul Gunasekhar, the former dean and senior faculty, Professor Prema Kumari, head Department of Materials Development, Professor Julu Sen, head ELT, distance education, Professor Anuradha, and my colleague, Professor Chanchala Naik, from the Department of ESL Studies. Then a lot of my MS students from the course Language Through Literature, and many research scholars from our school and as well as from other schools. So may I request you to deliver the talk. Thank you very much.
I want to thank Anand for giving me this very rare opportunity to give a talk not only to students who in their salad days are likely to accept whatever I say as gospel truth, but also to colleagues and good friends of mine whom I have built up friendships with over the last 30 years. I'm extremely pleased to find many of them here today. Thank you. I wasn't expecting that though. And I had in fact prepared a talk which is really meant to be a classroom activity and a lot of practical work. With the help of the students and your cooperation, we can try and understand how poetry works in the classroom. I was also not expecting a recording of this kind, so I'm getting very self-conscious now. Well, as Anand very appropriately put it, Roman Jakobson's famous remark that there is really no cause for this unnecessary division in English departments between people who teach literature and people who teach language, as though the two are two different things. There's really no need for that. In fact, there's a symbiotic relationship between people who profess literature and those who do language. How can you possibly be a good language teacher if you are not exposed to the best that has been taught and written in a particular language? And that, of course, is usually in literature, which, of course, becomes the site for an extraordinary exuberance in the use of language. And then how can you be a good literary scholar if you're completely tone deaf to grammar and if you have no interest whatsoever in the way words play and words come together in a playful fashion? If you don't have an appreciation for that, you couldn't possibly appreciate good literature and talk about it in any interesting fashion. So with these preliminary remarks, I'll draw attention to two or three definitions of poetry which I'm sure all of you are familiar with. One of them, of course, comes from Alexander Pope, who said that poetry is what was oft thought, but never so well expressed. What oft was thought, but never so well expressed. So which means that the emphasis is on the saying, on the way in which words are put together. All of us have thoughts. All of us are guilty of thinking. But not all of us are guilty of expressing those thoughts in the best possible way. The differential between someone who uses language in an ordinary way and someone who is a poet is precisely in the poet's capacity to express himself or herself in excellent ways. And that takes me on to another definition of poetry which Coleridge gave, which is, when he talks about prose, he says words are in a good order. But when it's poetry, the best words in the best order. That is what Coleridge would define good poetry as. And then, of course, we have other definitions too. And I'm thinking of Wordsworth. Everybody knows Wordsworth's quotation about poetry being the spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings. But not many people seem to remember the second part of that wonderful quotation, which is taking their origins in emotion, recollected in tranquility. That second part, I think, is very crucial, because poetry is hardly a spontaneous activity. If you think of a man like Dylan Thomas, who wrote poetry which was fire and brimstone, which seemed to have an overwhelming flow, and if you realize that Dylan Thomas used to revise his poems sometimes even 60, 70 times before putting it into print, then you'll realize that the spontaneity there has been worked for. It has been created. It has been struggled with. And then the spontaneity is actually a performance. It's not something which is natural. So when Wordsworth says poetry is the spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings, he's right. Of course, a person who's a poet has an impulse. He or she experiences something in the world and gets profoundly affected by it, and then would like to find the right kind of words to, you know, express those initial thoughts. But no poet worth his or her salt is likely to express himself or herself immediately. There'll always be a gap, even if it's only a 2-minute gap, between the original experience and the expression of that experience. Something has happened in those 2 minutes, or in those 2 hours, or in those 2 months, or in those 2 years. when Wordsworth was walking around in the Highland Hills, he happened to encounter a woman who was reaping and singing by herself. And he wrote down a little diary entry saying, I walked around in the hills and I saw a solitary reaper who was reaping and singing by herself. But then he forgot about it. And then much later, when this experience came back to him with all its immediacy, he began to compose the poem which all of us know, Behold Her Single in the Field, Yon Solitary Highland Lass. Alone she cuts and binds the grain and sings a melancholy strain. Oh, listen, for the vale profound is overflowing with the sound. Of course, I've not quoted all the lines. Stop here, gently pass, he says. Alone she cuts and binds the grain and sings a melancholy strain. Oh, listen, for the vale profound is overflowing with the sound. So it ties up with his idea that poetry is a spontaneous overflow, no doubt about it. But then he goes on to say, no nightingale did ever chant more welcome notes to weary bands of travelers among Arabian sands. And then you pause for a minute and ask yourself, why is he saying nightingale? He could have said crow, but he did not. He didn't say cuckoo, but he said nightingale. And if you know the English language well enough, and if you know what the nightingale symbolizes, then you'll realize that the nightingale has some connections with some story, ancient story. And that story is of Philomela, so rudely forced by Tereus, seduced by him, raped by him, and then confined to a tub. And in that tub, she was weeping. And the gods took pity on her, translated her into a bird, allowed her freedom so that she could sing the sweetest songs. And the sweetest songs are those that tell of saddest thoughts. And of course, the nightingale is well known for singing beautifully. And very often those beautiful songs are melancholy in nature. Now, Wordsworth knew the story of the nightingale. And he expects you and me, who think that poetry is a spontaneous overflow, to also sit back and ask ourselves, why nightingale? Why not crow? Why not cuckoo? Why not peacock or something or the other? Nightingale is there not by any accident. It is not adventitious. It is deliberate. And that is the whole point that Wordsworth is saying, when I am talking about the reaper, I'm talking about solitude. After all, he says, behold her, single in the field, yon solitary Highland lass. Then he goes on to say, alone she cuts and binds the grain. He doesn't say she cuts and binds the grain alone. All of us who do language understand the importance of emphasis. If you want to emphasize aloneness, solitude, solitariness, then you say, alone she cuts and binds the grain and sings a melancholy strain. Oh, listen, for the vale profound is overflowing with the sound. And then this wonderful introduction of the nightingale. No nightingale did chant more welcome notes to weary bands of travelers amongst Arabian sands, and so on. It means that here is a poet who was certainly impelled by the experience he had of seeing a woman cutting and binding all by herself. He must have speculated also that evening when he was walking around, why is it that she is by herself? Why is she singing to herself? What kind of song is she singing? Maybe she is singing about some ancient wrongs, some ancient hopes. She may be singing about some terrible tragedy in her family. We don't know. But all we know is that she is singing a melancholy strain. And that melancholy strain is sweet, beautiful, and exquisite. And only one bird in the whole of classical mythology has that capacity to sing sweetly and sing about sad things. And that is the nightingale. Okay? So here is a poet who is very deliberate in his use of language. We should not be carried away by the fact that the poem seems to be coming so overwhelmingly in a kind of a spontaneous overflow. That overflow is there, but it is worked for. It has been created. It has been constructed. It has been put together. It has been crafted. And when you think of that, no poet worth his or her salt. And there are good women poets all over the world. They write deliberately. Nobody writes just like that. Many of us think that we are poets because we had an impulse and we put something into paper. And then the next time, about 20 days later, we look at the poem and say, oh, it doesn't look too bad. We'll read it out to our friends. And we come and read it. There cannot be anything more irresponsible than that. You should be writing a poem, revising it, polishing it up, crafting it, putting it together, constructing it. And that is precisely what happens in good poetry. When Pope says that poetry is what oft was thought, but never so well expressed. Or when Coleridge says, prose is words in a good order, but poetry is the best words in the best order. And then when Wordsworth says, poetry is a spontaneous overflow of powerful feelings, but taking their origins in emotion, recollected in tranquility, all three of them, and they of course are echoing what many other poets have said, are actually talking about the constructedness of poetry, the formal principle of writing poetry, the linguistic conundrum a poem is, a field of linguistic play. That is what a poem is. And if we keep that in mind, then we begin to read poetry with great attention, with greater attention than we normally have. And we look at these poems and see the way in which words have been put together. So I do believe that in what passes for language teaching, the study of poetry can be a very, very useful and central exercise, and it can help people appreciate the nuances of language better. There is, of course, a tendency in our profession these days, particularly in the intermediate classes, schools, engineering colleges, and so on, to get rid of literature altogether, as though language can be taught in some kind of a vacuum. And I am one of those persons who is very conservative in this, who believes that even in the schools, we ought to be able to put in a Shakespearean text or a Miltonic text. That is continuing to be done only in the ICSC syllabus, where the senior Cambridge examination, the old senior Cambridge examination, even today demands that teachers teach Shakespeare. I think Julius Caesar or something is the current text in the ICSC. But then the problem now is that the teachers themselves are ill-equipped to teach Shakespeare. And that's a terrible situation where we can say, oh, school teachers are terrible. But who are those school teachers? They are simply the ones whom we brought out from universities and sent back to the schools. So it's a vicious cycle. And somewhere we probably require to do something in our profession to balance out things, to make people understand that while language exercises are extremely important, they can be made very interesting with the help of good literary texts. And amongst literary texts, a privileged genre, in my opinion, would be poetry. So in what follows in the next 45 minutes or thereabouts, I shall deal with some poems which are with you in your handouts. You'll notice that I have put a number of notes there. I apologize for that, because the element of surprise will be lost. But nevertheless, I think we can have fun together reading these poems and trying to understand how words alone are certain good. Before I do that, let me again invoke my favorite literary critic, and that is Matthew Arnold. Matthew Arnold was extremely concerned about the state of culture in society. He believed that the opposite of culture is anarchy. And anarchy is something which a society can ill afford to have. And he believed also that if people have to be cultured, It has nothing really to do with birth or with class or anything, though of course there's a class dimension in Anand's thinking. It has much more to do with your ability to be sensitive to the best that has been thought and said in the world. In other words, literature. If you are conscious of literature, if you read good literature, if you are sensitive to the way language is used, then there is a good chance that you will be a cultured human being. And amongst the literary texts, of course, for him, poetry was, of course, the privileged genre, where the best words, the best order and form and the capacity to say things effectively is seen in its most foregrounded form, poetry. And he said that if we want to judge good poetry, suppose Mohan Ramanan writes a poem and you want to judge whether this poem is good or bad, how would you do that? You should take cognizance of the literary consensus, the critical consensus. People have over the years agreed that certain writers are well known, they are classics, that they have used language well. And therefore, the best lines of Mohan Ramanan's poems, if you can detect the best lines there, that is, of course, balance it with the best lines in literature over the years. And then when you balance it, you compare and contrast, you'll find that Mohan Ramanan is lighter. And therefore, he should be thrown out of the canon. He cannot enter the canon. But assume, miraculously, that Mohan Ramanan can actually weigh equally with, shall we say, Shakespeare or Milton or Wordsworth or anyone else, then he can enter the canon. So this is how Anand spoke about the business of criticism. The function of criticism at the present time is basically to be able to do comparison and contrast of literary texts, weigh them, use a touchstone method, and see whether the gold is good or not good. And of course, he had a view that there are certain kinds of critical practices which over the years have been very popular, but which are not very effective or not very true. One of them, of course, the historical estimate. That is, we have this tendency, and particularly in India, we have this belief that anything which is old must be good. The older, the better. Right? Of course, we all know that something which is old is not necessarily good. There are many things in our tradition which we should throw away because they are not of any use to us today. It will not help us to live our lives better in a more humane fashion. Sati, for example, had to be thrown out. We don't believe in sati today. We don't believe in many other things which have blighted our society. So it doesn't mean that anything which is old is necessarily good. But in literary analysis, there are many people who say, oh, this is antiquated. This is something which is antique, which is 4,000 years old, 10,000 years old. Therefore, it must be good literature. There is no necessary connection between age and worth. In fact, the older one gets, the more worthless probably one gets also. All right? Therefore, no connection between a historical estimate and real criticism, real judgment of the worth of a literary text. Second, he says there are people who say personal estimates. Historical estimate is a false estimate. But the personal estimate is also false. And what is the personal estimate? Many of us say, okay, I am Catholic or I am Hindu. Therefore, I like this poet because he or she is a Catholic poet or he or she is a Hindu poet. Or I am a feminist. Therefore, this poet is bad because he or she does not speak well of women. Take W.B. Yeats' poem, Prayer for My Daughter. That poem is one of the most seductive poems in the English language. And yet, you'll find that some of the thoughts which Yeats comes up with in that poem are absolutely unacceptable to most of us here. I think to every one of us here, because we all believe in gender equality. We all believe that there's no particular reason why a woman should be confined to her home just to look after the guests and cook for them, while the men go out and do all the manly things in order to earn a living or whatever it is. We don't believe that anymore. None of us seriously believes that. And yet Yates believed it. And he said that I want my daughter to be able to stay home and look after the house, to dispense hospitality, so that at every stage the beauty of custom and ceremony can be highlighted. How but in custom and ceremony can innocence and beauty be born, he says. And he wants his daughter to be rooted in one dear perpetual place. He doesn't want her to wander around. He doesn't want her to do foreign travel. He wants her to be rooted in her home, rooted in culture, so that she can create the necessary conditions for culture to emanate from that kind of hospitable behavior. Sir, he doesn't want her to be too beautiful, because he says beautiful women seem to have eaten some kind of a salad which is not good for them, and they begin to harm other people by using their beauty to destroy their integrity. Of course, we all know about how men are smitten by beautiful women and then they die longing and pining for what cannot be had. But that is not the fault of the woman, it's your fault. Right? But anyway, as far as Yeats is concerned, he believes that women shouldn't be too beautiful because they might affect men in a wrong way. Therefore, I would like my daughter, he says, to be ordinarily beautiful, just enough, handsome, so that she doesn't break anybody's heart. Now, when you look at such things in this poem, your anger begins to increase. Your anger begins to boil up. And then you say, what kind of a man is this who believes that this such things about women? And what kind of a man is this who believes, as he does in the famous poem called The Second Coming, where he says, turning and turning in a widening gyre, the center cannot hold, the falconer, the center cannot hold. Mere anarchy is loosed upon the world. The blood-dimmed tide is loose, and everywhere the ceremony of innocence is drowned. And then he goes on to say, the best lack all conviction, the worst are full of passion. And by that he means that you and I, ordinary folk, are the worst people. We are the ones who have the lot of intensity. But the best people, the aristocrats, the exquisitely beautiful people, these are people who don't have that kind of passionate intensity. So a man who's so anti-democratic, so anti-human, who also has these notions about women, is despicable. That's what we all feel. And yet, when you read Prayer for My Daughter or The Second Coming, you suddenly find yourself seduced by the beauty of the lines, by the beauty of the expressions. He says, in one poem of his, he says, O great chestnut tree, are you the leaf, the blossom, or the bole? Alright? He says, O brightening glance, how can we know the dancer from the dance? Beautiful lines. And this is the kind of poetry which Yeats is capable of. And he goes on to say, words alone are certain good. So, Coleridge once made a very important distinction. He talked about the distinction between the agreeable and the beautiful. If you're a literary critic, you mustn't go after what is agreeable to you. Simply because you are a Catholic, it doesn't mean that a Catholic poem is good. Simply because you're a Hindu poem is not necessarily good. But a Hindu poem could be terrible in terms of its form, in terms of its use of words, in the way in which it has been put together. So the beautiful has nothing to do with your personal feelings about things. You should be able to transcend your personal feelings, your estimate at a personal level, or your estimate at a historical level, and arrive at great literature because they have, as Matthew Arnold would put it, high seriousness. But they are a criticism of life, they have largeness, they have benignity. So what are the features of great literature according to Arnold? It must have largeness, it must have benignity, it must be a criticism of life, it must have high seriousness. And when you look at a line of a new poet, an individual talent, and then compare it with the best lines from the tradition, and you find that these lines have the same weight, the same magnitude,
same largeness, the same benignity, then you are in the presence of a good poet. This is what Anand would say good literary critics should be doing. In other words, Anand is talking about not only a poet who writes about high and noble thoughts, but also one who is able to put those noble and high thoughts in the best language, in the best form. And he gives you a number of examples. For example, he goes back in time to the Iliad, the famous epic by Homer, which, as you know, there's a very important scene there where Achilles and Hector. Hector is the Trojan warrior, Achilles is the Greek warrior, who has entered the war much later than before. It's something like Karna. Karna never gets into the war because he is excluded from the war for various reasons till the last week. And then, of course, he doesn't survive till the 18th day. 17th day, he gets killed. Karna and Achilles have a lot in common. Achilles is a sulker, someone who's all the time complaining, someone who seems to have an existential angst. And he doesn't want to enter the war because he has a problem with the king of Greece. But at one point, when he realizes that one of his friends, Patroclus, has been killed by Hector, he gets very angry and he enters the war. And that war, the high point of the war, is the battle between Achilles and Hector. Hector, greatest of the Trojan warriors, almost invincible. And for some reason, Achilles believes that Hector had killed Patroclus. Actually, that is not true. It was a mistake which Hector had made. Anyway, he has to be avenged. And therefore, they have a big battle. And then Achilles wounds Hector mortally. And then when he has killed Hector, he ties Hector's body to his chariot and goes around the walls of Troy a number of times, dragging the body behind him, dishonoring one of the greatest Trojan warriors. After that, he brings the body to his tent, leaves him out there for the vultures and eagles to get at him, and then goes into his tent and starts sulking, something which he likes to do all the time. And as he's inside that tent, the father of Hector comes seeking him. And the father of Hector's name is Priam. Priam is the king of Troy. And he's a very noble and great man. He's never lost a battle, but now defeat stares him in the face, and he wants to come to Achilles and make peace with him, and then request Achilles to give the body of his son Hector so that he can take it back for a proper cremation. In those days, they used to cremate the dead. Now, the laws of war in those days gave absolute control over the body and the property of the vanquished to the victor, which means Achilles could do whatever he liked with Hector's body. But since they had a code of chivalry and a code of honor, normally the vanquished would be given back to their family members for a proper funeral. It's the least one could do for great warriors. And Achilles is so angry that there's no guarantee that he's going to leave Hector or give Hector back to his father. And so Priam comes. And then Priam has to crawl into the tent. The tent is deliberately kept low so that the great king, who always walks up with his head upright, has to crawl and go under the tent, virtually bending low and then standing before Hector in an attitude of submissiveness. All this humiliation Priam accepts. And then Achilles asks him, "What have you come here for, old man?" And then Priam tells him, "I am Priam, the king of Troy, and I have come to ask you, a great warrior, to release the body of another great warrior whom you have defeated in battle. Fair and square, you have beaten him. But now it is necessary for you to release this body so that I can take it back to Troy and give it a proper funeral befitting one of our greatest warriors. Will you please allow him to be given to me?" Achilles looks at Priam, and remember that Achilles has lost everything in the battle. All his friends are dead. He has nothing really to look forward to. He's also defeated Hector, but it was a pyrrhic victory. It's something like the victory of the Pandavas in the Mahabharata war. At the end of the day, even their children are killed by Ashwatthama, if you remember. So there's nothing for them to look forward to. What is the big idea of Yudhishthira ascending the throne when everywhere around him he sees only death and destruction and the loss of culture? It's a Pyrrhic victory, not a victory at all. It seems to be a victory only in name, but not in fact. So Achilles tells Priam, and I'm giving you the English translation of the Greek, which I don't know. The Greek I don't know. But I can give you an attenuated English translation, only giving you the thought. But you can imagine what beauty the Greek must have had, because even the thought in English is so beautiful. It's a momentous event. It's a great moment in the poem. And at that time, Achilles is telling Priam, and I've heard, old man, that thou too, in past days, was happy. I've heard, old man, that thou too, in past days, was happy. Implying, of course, that there was a time when you were happy, I was happy, but now we've come to a point where none of us is happy. It's the moment, according to Arnold, which is fraught with high seriousness. It has benignity, it has largeness, it is a criticism of life, and it is a beautiful piece of writing. The best words in the best order, the most noble thoughts expressed in the best possible language, and therefore great poetry. So if you want to compare Mohan Ramanan's lines with Homer, you have to compare it like this, and you'll find that Mohan Ramanan falls short. Then he moves on from Homer to Milton. And here is Milton. Remember the great Book 9 of Paradise Lost. In Book 9 of Paradise Lost, we have Adam and Eve having a long discussion about their existential state. They are in a state of bliss. They are in paradise. They are enjoying themselves. They are cutting and binding, doing a little jobs, agricultural labor, each one doing it in companionship with the other. Both of them do the same work together, and so on. So there's a lot of innocence there. And at some point, Eve feels a little restless. And she tells Adam, look Adam, I think both of us have been staying together for too long. I need some space. And I need to move a little away from you, so that I can do some more work. And both of us together would produce more work, rather than staying together and doing work which is only half possible because both of us are doing the same work together. So Eve is wanting space from her husband, who is a rather boring fellow. And then she talks to Adam in very reasonable terms. And then Adam says, no, how can you do that? God has asked us to stay together. You're not supposed to move here and there. And I've also heard from the Archangel Gabriel that Satan has come into the Garden of Eden and he may try to attack you or me, and therefore you have to be with me because I have to protect you. The patriarchal idea that if a woman is not with the husband, something wrong could happen to her. Therefore, I would not allow you to go. I don't think you should go anywhere. But Eve, once she has thought about what she wants to do, is not going to accept any refusal. She says, solitude is sometimes best society, and short retirement urges sweet return. Solitude is sometimes best society. Yes, it's true. Solitude is sometimes a good thing. And short retirement, a little short space, you know, when I go away from you, urges sweet return. When we come back, we'll be even more loving to each other. And having said that, Eve moves away from Adam. Reluctantly, Adam sees her going, he's apprehensive, and then of course, it all happens like that. And Eve goes to some other part of the Garden of Eden, and there she does her work. And that is the time when Satan, in the form of a serpent, comes to her ear and says something to her, in the ear. And what is he telling her? He's asking her, who are you? She says, I'm Eve. What are you doing here? Oh, I have just taken some time off from my usual activities with my husband. I am now in another place doing some work of my own. Who are you? He doesn't tell us, tell her who he is. And then he says, you know, can you see the tree at the distance? She says, of course I can see the tree. You know what that tree is? Of course I know what the tree is, because God has told me it's the tree of knowledge. And then why don't we go close to it? And why don't we go and pluck the apple which is there, which is so luscious and so juicy? Eve says, goodness me, I cannot do that.
Because God has
said we can go near the tree, but we cannot touch the tree. And certainly we cannot pluck the apple, because by doing that, we'll be guilty of gross disobedience. And then of course Satan says, Eve, don't you understand why God has stopped you from eating that apple? You know what happens? If you eat that apple, you will become God. You will get knowledge, because it's the tree of knowledge. You're not supposed to be in this state of innocence. You should, in fact, go and eat that fruit. And if you eat that fruit, you will get divinity. You will get knowledge, and you will be equal to God. God is keeping you
in a state of suppression
by not letting you eat that fruit.
And so on and so on. That's how the argument goes on.
And Milton does this over a long book, Book 9 of Paradise Lost, which is a momentous book in Paradise Lost. And then at this point, Eve succumbs to the temptation which Satan has given her. And Milton puts it across like this. And so, in rash hour, forth reaching to the fruit, she plucked, she ate. Earth felt the womb. Nature, amidst her seed, gave signs of woe, but all was lost. So, in rash hour, forth reaching to the fruit, she plucked, she ate. Earth felt the wound, and nature amid her seed gave signs of woe, that all was lost. What is beautiful about these lines is not simply that it is the expression of a terrible moment in human history. Because what they did, what Eve did, was to disobey God. It was man's first disobedience. After eating the fruit, she goes and tells Adam, look, I have eaten the fruit, you also eat it. Of course, it's a speculation. If Adam had not eaten the fruit, what would be the history of the world? Alright? But then, of course, that's a patriarchal way of putting things. And Eve makes sure that Adam also commits the same disobedience as she does, because he is guilty of uxoriousness, as C.S. Lewis pointed out when referring to Paradise Lost. But what is more important about those lines is the monosyllabic way in which the lines move forward, the slowing down of the rhythm. It's a terrible moment in human history. By acting like that, God has been abandoned by Adam and Eve. And as a result of that first disobedience, I have to come and teach a class here, and you have to come and sit and listen to classes. Because we are all sinners as a result of that first disobedience. Momentous, a great, terrible moment in human history. Nothing short of it. But Milton is equal to the task. And so in wrath, so rash, only reaching is a double syllable low word. Reaching to the fruit. She plucked, she ate. Earth felt the wound. Nature, two syllables, gave signs of woe. Oh. The syllabic, the slow motion, the deliberate slowing down of the rhythm, the monosyllabic words, I think, give the game away. Because this is a terrible moment, and that terrible moment, Milton is almost saying, oh God, I hope she doesn't do it. I hope she doesn't do it. She still has time not to disobey, but then, of course, inexorably, she commits the disobedience. But Milton, by slowing down the rhythm, prolongs the agony, so to speak, and then makes us all realize what a terrible moment it was. Matthew Arnold, commenting on those lines, would say, these lines have largeness, they have benignity, they have high seriousness, they are a criticism of life. And if you want to look at an individual talent, a new talent, weigh the best lines of that poet, the best lines of Milton, and you find that nobody else can come as close to Milton as Only Milton can be of that level. Therefore, he is a great writer. Other people are not great writers. I'll give you one or two more examples. There is this moment in King Lear. In King Lear, you remember, of course, that Lear is a very stupid man. He thinks that love can be quantified.
So he asks
his daughters, Goneril, Regan, and Cordelia, how much do you love me? And Goneril, understanding that Lear thinks that love can be quantified, says, I love you 70%. Then Regan says, no, I love you 75%. As though love can be quantified. And Lear actually believes this when Goneril and Regan speak about love in quantifiable terms. He doesn't understand that it's a quality. And therefore he gives so much of his kingdom to Goneril, so much of his kingdom to Regan. And then he turns to his favorite daughter Cordelia, hoping that she will also quantify her love and tell him how much she loves him. She doesn't answer. Lear is angry. And then, after prodding her a couple of times, Cordelia says, what a daughter can say.
Only a daughter can say that.
I love you, father. As a daughter should love a father. Is there any other way of putting it? Is there any way of quantifying it? It's the same kind of stupidity when Antony and Cleopatra have this discussion about their love. And Cleopatra is needling Antony all the time and asking him, how much do you love me? You don't love me enough. And then Antony, of course, not quantifying love, he says, let Rome and Tiber melt and the wide arcs of the ranged empire fall. This is my place. That's his love.
He doesn't quantify.
He qualifies.
And therefore,
you have in Cordelia that capacity not to quantify, but to speak the truth about what love is like. I love you as a daughter must love her father. There's no other answer possible. Lear should have understood that. He abandons Cordelia, banishes her, and then
the tragedy of Lear begins as a consequence.
And at some point, when Cordelia comes back to him, he finds that she is the only sucker he has at a time when the other sisters are making common cause to defeat him and destroy him and take away even what little remains of his kingdom and his power. At that point, Cordelia is as killed by the machinations of the enemies. And then Lear brings the body into this stage. Normally in Shakespeare, of course there are violent scenes, but sometimes the scene is outside and then you hear about the repercussions of the scene in the scene itself. And at that point, Lear is, he's gone mad. And then the atmosphere there is of wind and thunder and lightning. All that is seen from the speeches, because actual effects are not there. But from the speeches, you can see the cracks and the birth, the clouds and so on. And the madness outside is matched by the madness within. And in Lear's mind, everything has gone haywire. And at that point, he doesn't know what to do.
And he says,
unbutton
my coat.
Now, on the face of it, a remark like that can even be misunderstood in any public place. But in the context of what is being said, unbutton my coat seems to suggest that here is Lear, whose heart is bursting, but his coat is preventing his heart from bursting.
Therefore, unbutton my coat so that my heart can burst. Matthew Arnold
points out that these lines have benignity, seriousness, and they are a criticism of life. They have high seriousness. And it goes on like that. I could multiply instances from literature to give you many more such instances. I will not do that. All I will tell you is that whether it is Pope or Coleridge or Wordsworth or Matthew Arnold, all of them are pointing to the importance of expression. That it's not enough for you to have noble thoughts,
but the noble thoughts must be expressed
in the best possible language also. Now,
we shall now take up some of these poems for analysis.
All of you have a copy of the text with you? No? Can you collect one from somebody or share it with someone? Okay. We will start with T.H. Lawrence's poem, Piano. And I'm going to expect responses from the class now, okay? People must speak so that this becomes an interactive exercise and not a monologue. I've done a monologue already for about 25 minutes. Now the time has come. Dialogue. Okay. Now, I made a few notes in the margin. You can read it. It will help you.
But at the same time, it may rob you of the excitement of the study because it's already
written out for you in one way or the other. It doesn't matter. The act of reading a poem is probably the most important act ever. Because when you're reading a literary text, you should be completely attentive to the nuances of words there.
And the meaning of a poem
doesn't come to you straight away. It very often comes after repeated reading. There are different kinds of poems, I agree. There are some poems which don't require too much in the way of intensive reading. But there are many poems where
you may not understand the meaning at its
first reading, and you need to do repeated readings to get at the true meaning behind it. Meaning, in my opinion, is probably, in a sense, less important than the music of the lines. When T.S. Eliot,
talking about modern man's predicament,
gives you a beautiful image. He says, "Let us go then,
you and I,
when the evening is spread out against the sky, like a patient etherized upon a table." You find a frisson, a sudden excitement about poetry. You begin to see something unusual happening here.
And that unusualness is something which
needs to be
apprehended. Sometimes,
when we listen to a piece of music, we don't understand the meaning.
And I'm talking about classical music,
where normally words are less present. I'm talking about Western classical music,
where there is a combination of sounds. And
it signifies something,
but it takes you
time
for you to understand or comprehend. And that is why T.S. Eliot once
said,
when he talked about modern poetry, it is sometimes
more important, he said, for you to apprehend a poem than to comprehend it. You first apprehend
the meaning,
apprehend the poem, try to grasp the overall structure, the significance, the mood, the tone, and then you sit back and then try to analyze the meaning and arrive at a conceptual framework and so on. Initially, if you're looking for meaning, you're probably barking up the wrong tree. And he had a very colorful image for this. He said, meaning in poetry
is like the sock which the burglar throws to the dog. When he wants to burgle a house, the dog is there. What he does is puts a bit of meat, and the dog is running after this piece of meat,
the meaning of the poem. While the burglar, which is that
the poet,
is doing his work quietly by going inside and stealing.
Similarly, meaning in poetry, if you're going to constantly run after
the meaning, you may lose track of the fact that there is something subtle going on in the poem, and that it is actually getting into your system, so to speak, through
a process of suggestion, through a process of
subliminal suggestion.
So it's more important to apprehend a poem than to comprehend it.
That doesn't mean, of course, that poems don't have meaning. Of course they have meaning.
But that is not the
first thing which you should be looking at. The way the words are used, the rhyme scheme, the irony involved, the music of the lines, the assonance, the consonance, the alliteration, all those figures which one associates with poetry and poetic composition are very, very important in the discussion of a poem. These are days when I think, because we have a great belief that literature must have a social purpose, that the political meaning of a poem is more important than anything else. And that if a poem does not lead you towards revolution or social reform, it's not worth writing. That's a popular belief now. In most English departments today, everybody is talking about cultural studies and the social dimension of literature, the political dimension of literature, the understated ideology of a literary text and all that. These are all important. But before you can get to those esoteric things, I think it's more important to do some bread and butter things, like looking at the words themselves, looking at the denotative meaning of a word, the connotative meaning of a word, looking at the irony implicit in a word, looking at the sound of a word,
looking at the rhymes, looking at the
alliteration,
and so on and so forth. So I would imagine that the sounds, the images, the rhythms, and the figures of speech of a poem are as important for us as the final message a poem delivers. That final message is important.
And of course, if you're a sociologically oriented critic,
you should
worry about it.
Whether this poem is helping the revolution or not, whether it is speaking up for women or not, all that is fine.
How it does it,
the manner in which it
does that, is I think far more. And I think you'll all admit that two poems which are about the same subject may not necessarily be as good as each other. One might be better than the other, precisely because the formal composition of the poem is better, more efficient. That is what I want to keep in mind when we deal with these poems. So when we read poetry, all our senses must be alert. And we should be conscious of the way in which words are making sense. Now look at the poem Piano. Can somebody read it for me?
Maybe you can
read it for us. Each line.
And that is not
grammatically necessarily correct. So you look at the sense of the poem and pause where you should pause in terms of punctuation.
I'll read that for you
for a minute. Softly, in the dusk, after all, remember the commas are there. Softly, in the dusk, a woman is singing to me. That's fine. Taking me back down the vista of years, till I see a child sitting under the piano in the boom of the tingling strings and pressing the small, poised feet of a mother who smiles as she sings. So now,
it is vain for the singer to burst into glamour with the great black piano, appassionato. The glamour of childish days is upon me. My manhood is passed down in the flood of remembrance. I weep like a child for the past.
Okay. Hymns in the gozi parlor. She is singing hymns. So there's a religious dimension to what the mother is doing, which is at variance with the song this woman is singing in the dusk, where she is singing into an appassionato. It's a love song, into a kind of an eloquence, into a kind of magnificent burst of melody. It has probably nothing to do with religion as far as one can see. Seems to be a contrast.
Betrays
me back till the heart of me weeps to belong to the old Sunday evenings at home, with winter outside
and hymns in the cozy parlor, the tinkling piano outside.
So, wonderful pen picture of childhood and about domestic bliss, about the religious atmosphere of the house. Incidentally, D.H. Lawrence came from such a family, and that is why he reacted to it. Too much religion bothered him. And finally, when he wrote his great novels, he was talking about man alive, instinctual feelings, a free love between the sexes, and so on and so forth, which were all at variance with the Puritan ideology of his time. But I'm not suggesting that there's an autobiographical dimension to this poem. We don't need to necessarily say that every poem is about the poet. Sometimes the poem may not be about the poet at all. When you read a person like Keats, when he says, how does it start, the Nightingale poem? How does it start? I'm forgetting lines.
My heart
aches and a drowsy hunger strains my sense as though hemlock had drunk.
We know that the eye there is Keats. We know it.
Okay, and then the experience of his
brother dying, the youth grows pale and spectacle
and dies. We know that it's about Tom Keats,
who died of consumption
or tuberculosis. In some poets, we know that the eye of the poem is the poet. But in many poems, the eye of the poem may be a mask or a person. In this particular case, it's a child which is listening, a man, an adult now, but who as a child used to enjoy the music on winter evenings under the piano sitting with his mother. Okay? So now, it is vain for the singer to burst into clamor with the great black piano appassionate. He brings the story back to the immediate moment when the musician in the parlor, not in the house, not in the house, in the music hall, comes up with a burst of melody, a kind of a flourish in the piano. It is vain because I've already been transported to my childhood and I'm in tears now and my heart is breaking. The glamour of childish days is upon me. The glamour of childish days is upon me. My manhood is cast down in the flood of remembrance. Even though I'm a man, that manliness is gone because the flood of remembrance makes me weep. I weep like a child for the past, which is over and gone. So it's not just about a mother singing, it's also about the past and all that the past might stand for. All the experiences, all the frustrations and the victories which a person may have had, all that is brought to bear on the way in which the poem has been put together. Now, this is just one poem which we have done, and I don't know how much time we have. It's already 11:20, am I right? We have time up to 12. Okay, so we can do one or two more poems. But you can see how the words, you know, accentuate the meaning. One word there actually tells on the meaning of another word. Nothing there is accidental. Every word adds to the total meaning of the poem. And then you find that you, after enjoying the way in which the words have been put together, you begin to realize the total meaning, which we have just tried to explain as a theme of past and present, of the present moment, allowing the poet or the speaker of the poem to go back to his past, to reminisce about the past, all the frustrations and the loves and the victories of the past come back to him, but he is unable to appreciate the music at the present moment, because even that appassionato, that flourish of the piano, is not likely to prevent him from the flood of tears which now overcomes him because of his remembrance of the past. I have been looking to the left too much. I must look to the right a little. And not everybody is a left winger. I'll now move to the next poem. We'll do the next one. And the poem which I have in mind is a narrative poem. See, there are different kinds of poems. And as you know,
genres
in poetry,
there are ballads, there are epics, there are lyrics, there are sonnets, and so on. Practically most poems which are not epical can be called
lyrics. In the old days, lyrics used to be sung.
But we don't
sing
poetry, we recite poetry these days.
But we have the narrative poem as well.
And I would like you to read the narrative poem, Sir Patrick Spence.
The king sits in Dunfermline Tower, drinking the blue-red wine. Oh, war, will I right sailor to sail the ship of
Okay, man. I think I must explain it. Sorry. The king sits in Dumfermline as a place. Dump, D-O-U-N-E. It's old spelling, by the way. It's not modern English. It's an old medieval English. Okay? D-O-U-N-E is dump. Drinking the blue-red wine. Okay?
Blue-red wine.
Oh, what will I get, good sailor, to sail this ship of mine? Do you think you can handle it? Try.
Up and spake an elder mitch. He sat at the king's right knee. Sir Patrick Spence is the best sailor that sails upon the sea.
Okay, try. That's one.
The king has written a brave letter.
Broad letter, that's what it means.
Broad. And signed it with his hand. And sent it to Sir Patrick Spence, who was walking on the sand. The first line that Sir Patrick read, a loud laugh lost he.
A loud laugh laughed he. Sorry, I think I'm putting you to the difficulties. A loud laugh laughed he.
A loud laugh laughed he. The next line that Sir Patrick read, the tear blinded his eye.
Okay, I will spare you the agony. I'll read out from here. The first loud laugh laughed he. Laughed he. There's an extra syllable there. The next line that Sir Patrick read, the tear blinded his eye. Oh, what is this has done this deed, this ill deed done to me, to send me out this time of the year to sail upon the sea? Make haste, my merry men all. Our good ship sails the morn. Oh, say, no say, my master dear, for I fear a deadly storm. Late yestreen, I saw the new moon with the old moon in his arm, and I fear, my dear master, that we will come to harm. Oh, our Scots nobles were rich, were right low to meet their cock-hail school. But lang over the play was played, their hats they swam a boon. Oh, lang may their ladies sit with their fans into their hand, or ere they say Sir Patrick Spence come sailing to the land. Oh, long, actually lang means long, may the ladies stand with their gold combs in their hair, waiting for their own dear lords, for they will see them no more. Half hour to Aberdour, it's 50 fathom deep, and there lies good Sir Patrick Spence with the Scots lord at his feet. A little difficult in terms of the pronunciation of the words. It's a Scottish poem, but then it's still part of English literature. Can't help it. Okay? But I am not interested so much in the Scottish pronunciation of the words, but the way in which the poem comes together. And the narrative skill with which a huge, vast incident is compressed for you in the form of a short narrative poem. Let's now look at it. Would anyone like to paraphrase the poem, give us the story a little quickly after having read it? Dumfermline Town. So the king is sitting in his own town called Dumfermline, drinking the blood red wine. Immediately we get the feeling that this king is a chap who drinks more than he should rule. Oh, what will I get, good sailor? Where will I get a good sailor? Where will I get a good sailor to sail this ship of mine? I have the ship, I need to get to another part of the world. Where is the sailor who will sail the ship for me? Okay? Up and spake an elder knight, an older knight, an elderly knight, sat at the king's right knee. The right knee gets connected with another reference to feet later in the poem. Can you detect that?
Go to the last line, with the Scots Lord at his feet. Okay, now this is just one example of how words get repeated in a poem and add weight and meaning and significance as a consequence.
Up and spake an elder knight, sat at the king's right knee. Sir Patrick Spence is the best sailor that sails upon the sea. So the knight tells the king, who's drinking, that I think the right person for this job is Sir Patrick Spence, and he's the best sailor of the seas. So why don't we employ him? The king has written a broad letter. Broad letter. Broad in the sense that it is a general letter placing the responsibility on Sir Patrick Spence. He cannot refuse this offer because the king is telling him. So it's a broad letter, and signed it with his own hand, with his hand, and sent it to Sir Patrick Spence, who at that time was walking on the sand. So you see, the compression of time, not giving too much detail, not too many descriptions. If you have an epic poem, you'll have a long description of the sand, of the sea, of the kind of walking which Patrick Spence is doing. But here, there is no place for that. Economy of words. Okay? And sent it to Sir Patrick Spence, was walking on the sand. So immediately, like a camera panning from one thing to the other, we begin to see that the letter has come and Patrick Spence reads the letter while he's walking on the seashore. The first line that Sir Patrick read, a loud laugh laughed he. Laughed because of the number of words in the line. The scanning of the line is important. Prosody is important. We'll talk about that a little later. A loud laugh laughed he. The next line that Sir Patrick read, the tear blinded his eye. Okay? The tear blinded his eye. Oh, what is this has done this deed? Who has done this deed to me? I was not ready for this travel at all. I know that this is not the time to set sail. This king wants us to set sail at this precise moment. None of us will survive this adventure. Oh, what is this has done this deed? This ill deed done to me. It's an ill deed, evil deed done to me. To send me out this time of the year to sail upon the sea. At this time of the year, it's a bad time to sail. People will not survive. The ships will flounder. Then, having made this statement, he doesn't stop. The next verse immediately tells you Patrick Spence is ready to sail. There is no hesitation. Once he's been told to do something, he does it. And the poem shows that economy of expression by saying, make haste, my merry men all. Our good ship sails the morn. That's what Sir Patrick Spence tells his sailors. Let's all sail now. Tomorrow morning we're sailing. Look at the compression. No description. No ands and buts and perhapses. Directly giving you a dramatic moment. And these dramatic moments, I think, give this poem a wonderful structural coherence. Make haste, my merry men all, our good ship sails the morn. And then there is another voice. In this poem, the voice is multiple. We have the king, we have the elder knight, we have Sir Patrick Spence, we have the sailor, we have so many people speaking. Oh, say no, say, my master dear, for I fear a deadly storm. The sailor warns him, saying, please don't say that about sailing, because I fear a deadly storm. And then comes a wonderful image, which all of us have seen, of the new moon. When the new moon comes on, the shadow or the vestige of the full moon is still there. And you can you can see the larger circle of the moon. But this little moon is sitting in, so to speak, on a couch made up of the older moon, right? That image. Late, late yestreen, I saw the new moon with the old moon in her arm. Beautiful, right? The old moon in her arm. And I fear, my dear master, that we will come far. Now Coleridge, writing Dejection, an ode, many years later,
used these lines as his key, as a kind of an epigraph, to talk about his own dejection. Right? So you see how a statement made in some old poem becomes the starting point for an exploration of a poet's own dejection several hundred years later. This is called intertextuality. Late yesterday, I saw the new moon with the old moon in his arm, and I fear, my dear master, that we will come to harm. The image is very, very beautiful. It's a premonition also. So we already hear some hints that things are not going to be all right. Sir Patrick Spence himself says, somebody has done an evil deed by asking me to sail tomorrow. But then he doesn't stop because he's a great sailor. He says, we'll sail. And then one of the sailors says, I fear that we will not be able to survive this. Oh, our Scots nobles were right loath to wet their cock-heeled shoes. But long before the play was played, their hats they swam ashore. That is, he's talking about the Scots noblemen who don't want to wet their feet at all, but who ultimately also sink along with the ship, and their hats are floating in the sea, which means they have drowned, hats are floating in the sea. It's a grim prediction. Oh, long, long may their ladies sit, their ladies who are waiting for them, they'll be sitting in their homes, in their castles, and they'll wait for a long time, because they're not ever going to see these Scots nobles come home because of the king's stupid idea that we should set sail so soon. Oh, long, long may their ladies sit with their fans into their hand, or ere they see Sir Patrick Spence come sailing to the land. Long before they see Sir Patrick Spence come sailing to the land. Oh, long, long may the ladies stand with their gold combs in their hair. They have combs in their hair, they are beautifying themselves, and that's a good image. Waiting for their own dear lords, for they will see them no more. All these lords will die in the ship. Half hour, halfway over, halfway through the journey to Abadur, to the place called Abadur. It's 50 fathom deep. The ship is floundered and 50 fathom deep. And there lies good Sir Patrick Spence with the Scots lords at his feet. Until then, all the Scots lords were sitting on the right feet of the king. Now all of them are sitting, are dead, and are there at the feet of Sir Patrick Spence. Now this is a narrative poem. And you can see that through repetition, through rhyme, okay? Town, wine, sailor, mine, night, me, sailor. There's a rhyme scheme also of some sort going on here. There's a whole series of verses, and ultimately you have a structural coherence because of the way in which words are repeated, ideas are repeated. The subject, of course, is Sir Patrick Spence, but the theme is the cruelty of a king, or the callousness of a king, or the malice of a king. We don't know, one can speculate. The heroism of Sir Patrick Spence, and then the tragedy of having to comply with the orders of an authoritarian monarch, and the death and destruction of everybody who goes out to sea on that basis. Okay, we move from here. We take a point to move more points. I'm going to take you to My Papa's Waltz. This is by Theodore Rocky, who is an American poet. Is it making any sense? Waltz, dance.
The whiskey on your breath could make a small boy dizzy. But I hung on like death. Such waltzing was not easy. We roamed until the pans slid from the kitchen shelf. My mother's countenance could not unfrown itself. The hand that held my wrist was battered on one knuckle. At every step you missed. my right ear scrap a buckin. You beat time on my head with a palm cat hard by dirt. Then waltz me off to bed, still clinging on your shirt.
Okay, nice, thank you. I think simple enough poem in terms of length.
The last poem you spend about
5 or 10 minutes on it. But we need a lot more responses from everywhere.
I'm not able to hear anybody from the back. Will anyone like to volunteer a quick explanation of the poem from the last row? Last row? They're only taking photographs, but no. Would you like to try? No?
Anyone there? Left extreme? No?
Okay.
Right, let's see.
Now, what is the subject of this poem? My father's
dust.
The waltz.
Waltz is a dust.
Very vigorous dust. You can see from the words. But the theme of the poem is not just that.
The attitude of the who? Of who? Of the father. The attitude of my papa's waltz. Remember the title? My papa. So somebody is speaking, right? Who? The child is speaking, right? The son is speaking.
It is the son. Are we sure
about that? That is the son. Not a woman, girl. You don't know. My papa's waltz. But where do we get to know that it's a son?
Second line. It says boy, right?
Okay.
Okay. So it's a boy
who is being held by the father, and then a dance is going on. It's a vigorous, almost violent activity. It's in the kitchen of all places, and mother is very, you know, angry. She's frowning. She's unable to unfrown herself.
The word unfrown herself.
So it's a wonderful image of a family. But the father, what kind of a man is he? Is there anything which indicates that the man is a little cranky or that he is not very stable? Anything which says that? His whiskey breath, right? The whiskey on your breath.
He's drunk. Yes. Yes.
Exactly.
The man is sozzled. He's done drunk. And he's come home after a night of strong drinking, heavy drinking. And he picks up his son and then starts dancing around with him. He's apparently
in high spirits. The son is not very sure what his attitude to the father should be. Should it be one of anger? Should it be one of
affection? Should it be one of fear? Should it be one of reverence? We don't know.
And I think all these emotions, I think, are suggested in the poem. It's a very beautiful poem, in my opinion.
But it's an experience, okay? It's in the kitchen.
The kitchen is a space of the mother. The mother is very upset that the father is doing all this
and breaking down all the crockery and whatnot.
By,
you know, swinging the child all over the place.
The whiskey on your breath could make a small boy dizzy. Right? A small boy dizzy. But I hung on like death. Holding on to my father, like death. I couldn't detach myself from him. Such waltzing was not easy.
And also there's a rhyme scheme in the poem, as you can notice. So the form and control of the poem is determined by the rhyme scheme. It's not free verse.
Okay, breath, death, dizzy, easy, pan, countenance, shelf, etc., etc.
We go on like that.
We romped.
Look at the word.
The word romped. The romping. The
romping is like, you know, going crazy,
like the monkeys in the Sundarakanda of Ramayana. After Hanuman has discovered Sita and come back,
all the monkeys go into that little grove which is sacred to Sugriva, and then start drinking the wine and, you know, beating each other up and merrymaking. They are romping through that forest and angering Gadimukha, who is the chief, who is supposed to be looking after the grove, who is answerable to Sugriva for the destruction of the grove sacred to him.
We romped. That's
They're just the right word, right?
If this word had not been used,
the poem would have fallen flat.
We romped until the pans
slid from the kitchen shelf. So things have been, you know, broken down. We can clearly see that the waltz is the mad romp through the kitchen.
My mother's countenance could not
unfrown. She couldn't smile. Because she's first of all upset that the husband has come home drunk. Second, she's even more upset that he has now touched the child with this drunken, in this drunken state. Third, she's even more upset that she takes the child and goes around doing this. Fourth, she's even more upset that the pans and the crockery are all breaking up. I think you can imagine the situation. So beautifully done. The hand that held my wrist. So he's holding his boy by his wrist, not necessarily by two hands.
With one hand.
And then,
pushing him around like that. The hand that held my wrist
was larger on one knuckle. The father had
battered himself in the knuckle somewhere. Obviously, my mother had a brawl or something.
At every step you miss, that was the point which somebody made here, miss, my right ear scraped a buckle.
My right ear went
close to a buckle or something in the body, which scraped my ear. So there's violence here.
The father doesn't seem to understand that he's actually hurting the child.
And yet, there is affection in the father. That in high spirits, he's taking his child and having a great time.
And the son is not too sure what his response to the father should be.
Should it be one of fear now? He's of course afraid, but he's also delighted at the idea
of being swung around. So both, all these emotions are brought out in the poem so beautifully.
You beat time on my head. So one hand wrist,
the other hand
beating him on the head and beating time in the waltz. With the palm caked hard by dirt. The palm is caked hard by dirt.
All kind of filth on his hand is all caked up. And then with that hand he's giving the child a few strokes on the head as a rhythm. Then waltz me off to bed. Then takes the child off to bed and puts him in the bed. Still clinging to your shirt.
I'm still clinging to your shirt.
I think you can see the words like waltzing, romp, clinging, these verbs
that are used. See, English is a
verbal language. You use the word in two meanings.
What are verbs?
The farmer pounds the rice.
The cat
kills the mouse.
That kind of transitive energy from the subject to the object makes English particularly vigorous language. And in poetry, you'll often find
that poets use verbs more often than they use
adjectives. Adjective excess is something you and I are guilty of.
When we write a term paper, we say,
three, four words
for one idea.
But words which have verbal energy are verbs, action words.
And I think we find that happening in this poem.
Okay, this is just a little peek into the world of poetry.
I have not spoken about alliteration, for example, the rapid rifles, the stuttering rifles, rapid rattle, says Wilfred Owen in one poem, one of his poems.
That is alliteration. Oh, listen to the vague profoundness,
overflowing with the sound is assonance,
where the vowel sounds give kind of a meaning to the words. I have not spoken about many other parts of speech or poetic qualities, but with the little time available, I tried to impress upon you the need to read poetry attentively
and then see, enjoy the poem.
Before you ask for politics and identity and this and that, first read the poem, get the poem into your mind, let it be apprehended by you like a piece of music before you comprehend it and give it a meaning or a significance.
Thank you so much.